What is the mind?
Mind is how you think, how you feel, and how you choose.
Welcome to the Girlfriend Doctor Show. I'm Dr. Anna. I am thrilled to be here with you today. We are going to talk and dig into how to reframe and rewire our brain. Right now, in this season, the month of March, the theme for me and the theme for my Girlfriend Doctor Club is about resilience. And that is really about being strong in the face of challenges and to face the storm full on and to really learn how to see the silver lining. And the truth is, there's so much we can do to rewire our brain and to have joy and peace and patience and passion in the midst of all of this stressors that we face on a daily basis. So can't ignore them, but knowing how to deal with them and choosing what we focus on is essential to creating great health. Well, today I am bringing someone who has actually been a mentor to me. She has published 19 books. She's a leader in the space as a neuroscientist. She is Dr. Caroline Leaf. She's really an amazing woman, and she is so accomplished. She spent the last 30 years researching the mind-brain connection, the nature of mental health, and the formation of memory. She was one of the first in her field to study how the brain can change with directed mind input or neuroplasticity. And throughout her years of clinical practice, she's helped hundreds of thousands of people learn how to use their mind to detox and grow their brain to succeed in every area of their lives, including school, university, and the workplace. And what I really love about Dr. Caroline Leaf is that she's also incorporated into her business her daughters who work with her too. So I love that. Her latest book is Cleaning Up Your Mental Mess. And I've been dog-earing it and tagging it and underlining so many areas. And we're going to discuss her five steps to really rewire our brain. She calls it five simple, scientifically proven steps to reduce anxiety, stress, and toxic thinking. So oftentimes we go down the same path over and over and over again. Well, that's because we're wired that way. So we have to conscientiously change our wiring, change our thought process, and we can do it in the moment. I know many of you have known my story. With the tragic loss of my son, Garrett, I had incredible depression, grief, trauma, anxiety, PTSD. I was in the midst of it where I couldn't see it. So steps that I've taken over the years, steps to rewire my brain to live life and experience joy and happiness again, to recreate the strongest bonds in my family when we were so fragmented, have been a crucial part of why I'm here with you today and why I am so passionate about sharing Dr. Caroline Leaf and her work and her message with all of you today. So grab a pen, grab a paper, and I'll be right back with my guest, Dr. Caroline Leaf. Well, welcome, Caroline, to the Girlfriend Doctor Show.
Thank you. It's so lovely to see you again and to talk to you again. And you live in my hometown now. I didn't even know that, down the road, which is lovely.
I know. And I look forward to getting together for dinner and really connecting. I know, both in Dallas now. So that wasn't intentional, but here we are.
It's so interesting. Yeah, wonderful. Well, did you get power outages last week? Did you have the whole snow and...
Very briefly, but definitely the freezing temperatures had a toll on the building with some water pipes busting, you know, the crisis for everyone listening in Dallas. We had a big freeze right in the middle of February at the time of recording this, and it was challenging. How about you? How did you?
We lost power. We're in South Lake, so we lost power for 3 days and water for 2 days. So it was awful, and Wi-Fi and everything. We had to go to a hotel to actually work, and then sleeping back at home because we had all the pets and things with 1,000 blankets on us. And but it was, it was bad. It was, thank goodness things are good now again.
Yeah. It seems like the, infrastructures, there's a lot to be done.
Let's absolutely talk
about, and with a crisis like that, right? We, face this crisis and Southeast Georgia, I was used to hurricanes, never snow, but hurricanes. This creates a mental toll, unexpected, environmental. And I saw reactions all over because there's that Nextdoor app. I don't know if you got that Nextdoor app, but you can, your neighbors will, you know, I said, I can help with A, B, and C. And neighbors will, some will be very positive and encouraging, and others were like losing it.
Totally upset.
So the you know, when we're approached with this type of
acute trauma situations, we've got to manage them. And that's, well, the thing is, our, what we need to understand, and that's what I write about in my book, Cleaning Up Your Mental Mess, and what I've studied for now nearly 38 years, is what is the mind and how, what is a mental mess and what does it all mean, thoughts and things. And so when life happens, like these acute traumas that we have to face, like the recent storm that you just mentioned and whatever, I mean, COVID and politics, and those are sort of the big things. But then there's the little things that happen in our own lives that are not so little. Some of them are major crises. And then there's the little day-to-day things of just managing, you know, time and imposter syndrome and arguments and all those little things. All of that's mind. Mind is the source. Mind is the primary force. And if we don't understand mind, then we kind of get battered around. And that's what this book is about, to helping people to understand what mind is. It's been my sole aim of my research over the past 38 years. And even as a clinician, I practiced for 25 years working with people with dementias and traumatic brain injuries and learning disabilities and acute war trauma, and in the apartheid South Africa where I grew up, and in the transition and the post-apartheid, and from the rich to the poor to every socioeconomic, I worked tirelessly to try and understand what mind was, because it's one of those areas, Anna, that is just not researched. It's kind of, well, it is, but it's just kind of lumped under a stress response. Or, you know, one of the things you do along with green juices and a bit of meditation. And it's so much more, because it's the mind. You go to bed with your mind, you wake up with your mind, you choose your clothes with your mind, you eat breakfast with your mind, you listen to this podcast with your mind, you answer the next email. Your mind never stops. So if we don't understand mind, how do we clean up the mental mess? And if mind is always working, we really should make it a priority, because it's behind the scenes. It's the thing that drives everything else. And if you think of just coming into this pandemic, prior to that, we already had such a major problem with mind, because people have been, there's the deaths of despair. For years, people have been living longer because of the advances in medicine and technology. But between 96 and 2014, this trend reversed. So just prior to the pandemic, we already were in a state where mind had been sort of mismanaged, to the point where people were dying from 8 to 25 years younger from preventable lifestyle diseases. And now with a pandemic, that's added another year onto that. And all of that lumped together is telling us a story that as humans, for the last 40 years, we've been kind of obliterating the mind stuff, focusing so much on the biology, on the discoveries of neuroscience have almost consumed us, to the point where the brain and the body are everything. And you as a human with your story, well, that's just besides the point, because let's look at the symptomology and let's take the biomedical model, which you as a doctor, you know, works beautifully for the body, but it doesn't work for the mind, because the mind and the body are separate. So based on that, we have to understand mind in order to be able to know how to manage things like crises, etc., which is what this book's about. So it's a big mouthful.
Oh my gosh. And I love it, because I highlighted in your book, you know, here we are, Cleaning Up Your Mental Mess. Okay. This is out now in March at the time of this release. And I highlighted this one second. It said, it's time for society to start honoring people's stories and what we're going through, not make us feel like there's something wrong with us if we feel sad or depressed or anxious, or that we're abnormal and have failed in some way if we're not happy all the time.
That sums up what I was trying to say. That's why I developed this work and put this into this format, so that people can do it.
Define the mind, because like we can sit here and saying, I use my mind to do A, B, and C. I'm like, really? Like, what is the mind?
Yeah, it's a great question. So the way to, you would have seen
nothing
the quote.
Nothing easy, right? Nothing easy. It's got to be should just be this part of your anatomy, but no.
Well, that's how it's been presented, as being this part of your anatomy, that your mind and your brain are interchangeable. And for those of you that are just viewing, I mean, or listening, I'm holding up a brain and a skull, and I've got a body of a human body.
Not I love it, because I'm usually holding up a pelvis, you know, and everything else. So I love you've got your brain. I've got my pelvis.
There you go. Well, I've got kind of a combination there. So anyway, basically, we're not our brain, and our mind is not our brain. Mind and brain are not the same. But for the past 40 years, that has been the message. So most people think they're the same thing. And that's been to our detriment because it's made everything about the biology. So every symptom, every emotions have become symptoms of a disease instead of a warning signal of an underlying something that's going on in your life. I mean, there's a massive distinction there. So anything we experience emotionally and behaviorally have become symptoms of a disease or an illness. So we've medicalized misery. We've medicalized the human experience and reduced it down to biology versus seeing it as a unique person's story. And you can, like the classic example, and is that now in this COVID situation, just every day there's more science coming out and there's articles all over the place. Oh, we're in for a pandemic in mental health. We already had a problem prior to this. In fact, we've had a problem with mental health since the beginning of humanity. In other words, if you're human, you have mental health challenges because life is unpredictable. You can't control events and circumstances, but you can control responses. So mental health is not something new, this mental health thing. It's how we've managed it that is not good. We've managed it in this very biological way, and we've taken out the story element of a person's life and taken away the whole context and the community aspect. And also we are not dealing with the socio-political, economic kind of factors as well, and racism and all those things, which are contributing largely to anxiety. So for example, with this whole pandemic, we've got this whole acknowledgement of the isolation and the, you know, the experiences that we've had and the grief and the uncertainty and the medical threat of medical uncertainty and so on. That's all been happening, and we all acknowledge that that's made us anxious and depressed. Of course it is. That's totally normal response to adverse circumstances, and every period of history has gone through various different, you know, major things happening. World War One, World War Two, the Spanish flu, and then every generation, and then every family, and then every person is going through this. So we can't just go and say, okay, well, we acknowledge that, which we all agree that that's going to have an impact and make people feel, but it doesn't mean that you're sick. It doesn't mean that you have a mental illness. So that there's a paradoxical kind of thing going on where they're saying, yes, there is an increase in, and yes, people are more depressed. If you lose all your money and you lose a loved one, obviously you're going to be depressed. That's a very normal human response to have that grief. But to say that, okay, so we need to up the treatment plan, which is diagnose, label, and give medication and maybe a little bit of, you know, conditioning, that doesn't treat the problem. That's creating more of a problem. And we see that from the research, that approach for the last 40 years, which is what they're offering now as the solution, has really made things bad. So it's going to make a bad situation even worse. So we have to come up with an alternative. We have to come together and recognize that it's not the person's fault. It's the situation. And in fact, it's never, you know, we've got to acknowledge that we've got to own our stuff. So things happen to us. That's not our fault, but we are responsible for what we're going to do with that. And we need help to be able to manage that. Then the things that we do wrong, which we all do, because we're all experimenting. Life is one big experiment with our mind that we then need to own that. So if you've said something to someone and it's not nice, own the guilt and fix it. As opposed to, oh, I feel guilty and shame and condemnation, and then you don't do anything, and then that becomes worse, and then you're all anxious and you think you're sick because that's the message that's been given to you. So we have to shift all of that. We have to come together, take responsibility, talk about this. If you're human, whatever you are alive, you're a mental mess. How do we manage that? So in order to say all of that, we come right back to your question, kind of long lead-in, to what is mind and what is brain. So your brain is this. It's this physical part of you. But it's not your mind. If you're dead, this is dead. This goes. But with you being alive now, listening and watching, the energy force of your mind is what's keeping your brain and body alive. So your mind is this external force that also moves through the brain and the body. And psychologically, mind is how you think, how you feel, and how you choose. You never do those three things separately. You're always thinking. When you think, you will feel. When you think and feel, you will choose. You're always thinking, feeling, and choosing. That is mind. Mind equals think, feel, choose. You're always thinking, feeling, and choosing. You wake up doing it. You go to sleep doing it. You're always thinking, feeling, and choosing. And there's a consequence of thinking, feeling, and choosing, and that is a thought. And thoughts look like trees. And I'm holding up a little green plant. And like trees have got roots and branches, a thought has got roots and branches. So the thought now, at the moment that's been built, is about this whole mind, brain, COVID, pandemic, mental health, etc. And that's all the roots. This is what I'm talking about. This is the seeds that are being sown. I mean, and the root memories that are growing. This, the tree trunk and the branches are your interpretation of what I'm saying. So each person's interpretation, this part's going to be different for everyone, but the source is what I'm saying and what we're discussing. And that's how all experiences form, whether it's this discussion, whether it's the next conversation you have, whether it's the next email, whether it's the next plan you're making, is all based on these thoughts that we are constructing, and we construct them based upon our existing thoughts. And all of the construction process is mind. Mind is the constructor. Mind is the think, feel, choose of the experience, drawing up the past, putting it all together, building these thoughts into our brain and our body. So mind is this external force that is 99% of who we are. And it's not something weird. A quantum physicist won the Nobel Prize a couple of years back for their work on gravitational fields. Einstein did work on photons and the photoelectric effects and gravitational fields. This is quantum physics. It's one of the most accurate forms of science, of accurate branches of science, and fundamental branches of science. So we use all those quantum physics and electromagnetics and gravitational fields to understand that every human has their own unique gravitational field around them. And that's the physical side of the think, feel, choose. So think, feel, choose is over and all around, and it's gravitational fields. You've got yours, I've got mine. I can't take yours, you can't take mine, but we can enhance each other, or we can hurt each other, because we're impacting each other because of the relational nature of gravitational fields and of mind. So mind, think, feel, choose, gravitational fields, brain, physical. And you are not your brain. The two are inseparable. The mind needs the brain and body to be able to express you. And therefore, there's this inseparable relationship. So that's a long answer, but I think it kind of unpacks a lot of concepts.
Oh my gosh, and it's so good. And you do go into it so well in your book, Cleaning Up Your Mental Mess, which I found that it's been very, very helpful to me. And also the practical approach, which we'll go ahead and dig into. Now, the practical, you talk about five simple scientifically proven steps, but what we need to do to shift our mind, shift our experiences, our actions based on the stories that we've experienced, or that we have, or that we've, you know, made up, or we've heard about ourselves, that have been written on us by other people, like how we now shift the way that we interact and react in the world. And I think a couple things, you've got great diagrams in here. I'm like, oh yeah, fits the science geek in me just beautifully, as well as the research section. But the practical work, in that you did this in clinical trials to look at, number one, you know, the number of antidepressants, et cetera, hasn't changed mental health. The generational impact on our children of our mental health it's a generational impact.
Yeah, yeah.
And everything that we can do to shift our thoughts, our energy, right? And,
yeah.
Our behavior because I like how you say, you know, think, feel, and choose. This creates our thoughts, and thoughts, you know, create our actions, and how this will shift our behaviors and how we can live and enjoy life, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So it's so important that we recognize that it's human to feel anxiety and depression, that these are not bad things, that these, if you see them as bad and unhelpful, you actually will have the stress response in your body, which actually is designed to help you be more focused and get your brain and body prepared for whatever it needs to do in a sort of ideal functional state. If you see these as helpful, then your stress response will work for you and do that. It'll prepare you for wisdom and for the best next action. But if you see these as, oh, they're terrible, they're illnesses, I'm feeling anxious, there's something wrong with me, I've got a neuropsychiatric brain disease and all these scary terms that are out there, and there's something wrong and I'm crazy and all the implications, that makes the stress response work against you. So now you've got 1400 neurophysiological responses working against you instead of for you. And you know, that's going to throw your hormones out. That's going to throw your cortisol levels, your glucose, your DNA, I mean, everything. And yet we can change that. We can manage that process. So there is a response because the mind works through the body. So obviously the brain and body are affected, but because of the flexibility or the neuroplasticity of the brain and the actual variability or the ability of the body to change, the plasticity of the body as well. I mean, we're making a million new cells every second. Because of that, when we shift our mind, which is the driving force of any change in our brain and our body, we are going to impact how we function. And I say driving force because people think, okay, well, I can also do exercise. I can also eat healthy. we've got to do those because that's how you look after the physiology and the physical, but your mind's still in it. So you can be doing the most fantastic fasted workouts, eating the most clean diet of farm to table, wild, organic, you name it. But if you haven't got your mind managed, it's your mind that's behind the exercise. You have to use your mind to exercise. You have to move your mind, use your mind to decide what to eat and to eat. But if you're not in a state of mind management, you can lose up to 80% of the nutritional benefit of the food you're eating because you're, for example, your pancreas won't work properly, which means then your gallbladder, then the whole cycle of digestion gets interrupted by your mind mess, mental mess. But if you clean that up, then you get the benefit. So people think, okay, well, I'll go and do exercise to heal my depression. You must do the exercise. Your depression will definitely reduce because it changes the chemical structure and so on. But if you still don't sort out the issue, the toxic issue, you're going to lose up to 80% of the benefit and very fast. So the exercise long term won't help. You're still going to feel stuck. So we have to live lifestyles of mind management. We have to accept that depression, anxiety, fear, terror, grief, they're not going away. They're not going anywhere. And they're actually your friend. And I know this sounds crazy, but they're actually your friend because they are messengers of an underlying issue. So instead of seeing depression, anxiety, toxic thinking as an illness or something bad or evil, see them as helpful messengers telling you something. So you want to embrace them and process them and reconceptualize them because they grow into your brain, but they grow in as toxic structures, which are basically proteins that are folded incorrectly and chemicals that are flowing incorrectly and incorrect vibrations inside the basic proteins. I mean, I can go into all the science, but these are as real as if you had a COVID virus. Yes. So that the immune system of the body recognizes COVID as a virus and sends out immune factors, T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes, macrophages, etc. The immune system of the brain does the same thing with the toxic issue. So if you don't deal with that toxic issue that's causing the signal of worry or the signal of despair or the signal of all of those anxiety, depression, you then have an immune response in your brain going on, creating inflammation in this area. And it's inflammation is supposed to be a temporary protection. Like the immune goes to fight it and then, you know, you're supposed to deal with it and it goes away. But if you don't deal with your stuff, if you don't manage the mental mess, then that doesn't go away. But the minute you say, okay, I recognize depression and anxiety is helpful, I'm going to find out why. The minute you do that, the immune system response changes and so does all the neurophysiology change. So you still haven't totally fixed it yet because it's going to take time, at least 9 weeks to cycles of 63 days to fix. But the mere fact that you're in that state of mind that you're fixing is bringing healing and resilience into your brain and your body. And that's what the neurocycle is that I've developed over 38 years. I mean, it's a lot of clinical application and they're not just five. I don't do the quick steps. Technological age that we live in has created a quick fix mentality, hurry sickness, get it done fast, take the tablet, you know, do the fives, give me the five steps and I'll be better. No, you will not be better in 5 seconds. You can use the five steps because they're not a technique. It's a system of how to get your thinking, feeling and choosing under control so that you can direct the neuroplasticity of your brain and the health of your body. And then you can use it quickly in the moment to bring your mind back under control because we should be self-regulating all day long. But we've also got to identify the patterns in our life that are coming from the toxic patterns that are probably coming from an underlying trauma or toxic habits that we built. And those need to be addressed because if those aren't going away, those are causing brain damage and inflammation and messing up the hormones and all the implications, whether there's a genetic weakness or whatever. So the neurocycle is the basic system. It's not a technique. It's not a therapeutic. It doesn't replace therapy. It enhances therapy. You go to therapy once or twice a week if you are going, or counseling or coaching. What are you doing with yourself the rest of the week, the rest of the day, 24/7? Mm-hmm. So the neurocycle is pretty much how you manage your mind to be able to manage every moment and the big stuff. So in the moment and the big stuff. And I'll just sort of end off with that particular part with this, that we can go 3 weeks without food. We can go 3 days without water. We can go 3 minutes without oxygen. We don't even go 3 seconds without thinking, feeling, and choosing. So my argument is if you are doing it, and if you don't control it, it's a mess, producing this mess. So you may as well learn to self-regulate and mind manage. And that's what the neurocycle does.
And I think this whole concept of creating a lifestyle of mind management is going to be, you know, part of our healing as an individual, healing as a family, healing as a culture, a community, and world. And I'm excited to bring this information into our audience. So we are going to be right back in our next segment and really talk about these key ways that we can rewire, rework our thoughts, our feelings and our choices, right? We are working in the way we think, feel, and choose to create healthy behavior. And then again, right? It's about, like, I can't heal the body without healing the mind.
Exactly.
And it is, and it's crucial. It goes both ways. A healthy body leads to a healthy mind. A sick body leads to a sick mind. A sick mind leads to a sick body. And there's no way around that, for sure. And so it's a combination of the two. Thank you for watching this video. Be sure to subscribe to my YouTube channel here and get those notifications and comment below. Let me know your thoughts, what you loved, and what your action step is.